And this time, let's go ahead and read verses 1 through 5. Exodus chapter 12, verses 1 through 5. And the Lord spoke unto Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, saying, This month shall be unto you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year to you. Speak you unto all the congregation of Israel, saying, In the tenth day of this month they shall take to them every man a lamb, according to the house of their fathers, a lamb for an house. And if the household be too little for the lamb, let him and his neighbor next unto his house take it according to the number of the souls. Every man according to his eating shall make your count for the lamb. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a male of the first year. You shall take it out from the sheep or from the goats. Second verse here, this month shall be unto you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year to you. What God did was, whatever their calendar was, and I'm sure their calendar at that point was probably based on Egypt. But whatever their calendar was, God said, okay, I'm changing your whole order. From now on, this month, the month that you kill the lamb and that you enter into 7 days of unleavened bread, this is the beginning. This is your beginning. This is your new year. It's pretty cool when you think about it, isn't it? This, whatever you marked before, whatever you thought was important before, whatever held significance to you before, now, this month, now, this feast, now, this event, now, this lamb shall be considered the beginning for you. It's all brand new. It all starts here with the lamb. So, now, I want you to consider the fact that neither Moses nor any of the people that were there, that were of Israel, they didn't start believing in the true God that day. Do you understand? God says, this is the beginning of months. Let's look at the picture of what this is talking about. This is the beginning. What is the beginning? The Passover lamb slain. 7 days, or a continual feast. 7 days of making sure leaven is purged out and of eating of the unleavened bread that is Christ. Exiting Egypt and heading for the promised land. Crossing the Red Sea. Okay. This is your beginning, but What do we say the beginning was? Well, we say, well, that marks salvation. But folks, they already believed in the true God. They'd believed in the true God for 400 years before that and way before that. I mean, 400 years ago, they entered into Egypt as the people of God. They had a king over them, or at least second in charge. His name was Joseph, who believed in the true God and prayed to him. They all were believers and had been believers for, you know, a long, long time. I mean, as far back as Father Abraham. Father Abraham introduced them. He first met the true and living God, and he passed it down to his son Isaac, who then Isaac encountered the true and living God, and passed it down to his son Jacob, who also had an encounter, many encounters, with the true and living God. And changed his name to Israel and ended up calling the whole nation Israel after him, Prince with God. The beginning of everything, as God sees it, is not salvation. God totally changed the orders for those who already were saved. Totally changed up their order. And then called it, this is the beginning. Well, what is all that? You know, what's the significance of all that? Well, just let me see, make sure I don't. Yeah, I don't think we need to. We'll come back eventually here, but it'll be a while. Let's go to Gospel of Luke. Luke chapter 22, verse 7, starting with verse 7. Notice, we're going to read past verse 7, but notice verse 7 very specifically here. Then came the day of unleavened bread, when the Passover must be killed, and he sent, this is Jesus, and he sent Peter and John, saying, go and prepare the Passover for us, that we may eat. For who? For disciples. For believers who had met Jesus 3 years, 3.5 years earlier. I'm just trying to get you to consider the scriptures in light of this, that everybody I've ever heard teach on this is the Passover is salvation, the crossing of the Red Sea, and all of that. But these people, they had known Jesus, they had known the true God for a long time, and the disciples who were eating this feast of unleavened bread had been with the Lord for years. They were disciples. They were his disciples. But now, here's what I want you to consider. What is Jesus instituting on this day? Let's read on. Verse 9. And they said unto him, where wilt thou that we prepare it? Talking about prepare the Passover. And he said unto them, behold, when ye are entered into the city, there shall be a man meet you, bearing a pitcher of water. Follow him into the house where he entereth in. And ye shall say unto the owner of the house, the master saith unto thee, where is the guest room where I shall eat the Passover with my disciples? And he shall show you a large upper room furnished. There make ready. And they went and found as he had said unto them, and they made ready the Passover. Let's read further. And when the hour was come, he sat down, and the 12 apostles with him. Notice, this says 12 apostles. Do you remember when they were called? They were called 12 what? Disciples. They're down the road a little bit. Do you know how much it takes to come from a disciple to an apostle? I don't know, because I'm not there. But I mean, you know. And so it calls them apostles who are going to eat this with him. Verse 15, and he said unto them, with desire I have desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I say unto you, I will not any more eat of it until it be fulfilled in the kingdom of God. And he took the cup and gave thanks and said, take this and divide it among yourselves. For I say unto you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God shall come. And he took bread and gave thanks and broke it and gave it unto them, saying, this is my body which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. Likewise also the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you. So here, Jesus is sitting down with those who have followed him faithfully. We're not talking about new believers. We're not even, in a sense, talking about old believers. Because I believe that there were, and the scriptures declare this, I don't have to believe this, the scriptures declare this. There were people among the Pharisees who believed in Jesus. They just didn't leave the synagogue because they didn't want to, they just didn't do it openly because they didn't want to be cast out. There were people in the multitude. There were 70 that followed Jesus and were sent out to do great miracles and stuff like that all before this time. There were many people who believed on him. Jesus takes 12 of them. And he says, I have desired. This is Jesus talking. What does this mean? Come on, look into the heart of Jesus. Don't look in your own heart to find meaning. Look into his heart. Jesus is saying, I have really desired you believers to have Passover and unleavened bread with me. Man, the significance. At the same moment of having Passover, Jesus institutes the Lord's Supper, or the word communion. It's one and the same, except Passover is the shadow. Communion is the real. Eating of the Lord's table, that's the real. That's the real. Who eats of the Lord? I mean, after all, who eats of the Lord's table? Sinners? No. And a lot of times, folks, I know parents that are, even after kids are saved, are a little hesitant to let kids eat of the Lord's Supper, you know. They want them to have a little more understanding. There are some Christians, I know some Christians who for years didn't eat of the Lord's table because they felt like they needed to be in a certain place. Well, there is some reality to that. Now, let me just say this so that no confusion comes. When we have the Lord's Supper, when we have communion in this church, we have what is called open communion. If someone is a believer and they want to fellowship with that, we invite them to do that. We don't, you know, say, I'm sorry, we need to examine your life and do all of this stuff. The whole point is you've examined your life and you realize I need to eat his flesh and drink his blood. I need to partake of Christ in me. Can I get amen? You don't, you know, I also know people who say, well, I can't eat of the Lord's Supper. I'm too unworthy. And they base that on scripture. One scripture says don't eat it unworthily. That just means don't eat it ignorantly, not understanding what it's for. You're not the lamb, put the lamb in you. You're not the bread, put the bread in you and become one with that. You're not the life, drink of the life and put it in you. That reality. Also, just to give a little more well-rounded picture, over in Matthew chapter 26, this is a same story with just a few extra added things. Matthew 26 and verse 17. Now on the first day of the feast of unleavened bread, and let me say this, there are times when the Feast of Unleavened Bread is just the term that they use that includes the eating of the Passover lamb on the 14th, as well as the next 7 days. So it's just a term that they use for the whole event of Passover. So now on the first day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread, the disciples came to Jesus, saying unto him, where wilt thou that we prepare for thee to eat the Passover? It just occurred to me how strange that must have been for Jesus, who his whole life was set to be the Passover lamb. Before there was a first Passover, before the world began, was a lamb slain before the foundation of the world. How strange that must have been for him to go tell the disciples to go find a place and to kill a lamb. You know, and Jesus is looking at him killing that lamb and going, that just ain't going to do it, you know. I'm it. And yet, how much like religion is our minds of taking of something, a ritual of communion or something, and finding some sort of a relief or spirituality in a ritual and not walking, living, having a continual feast, enjoying the Feast of Unleavened Bread, the Passover, and not really continually eating the lamb and purging and bringing and partaking of the unleavened bread. So, verse 17, Now on the first day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread, the disciples came to Jesus, saying unto him, Where wilt thou that we prepare for thee to eat the Passover? And he said, Go into the city to such a man, and say unto him, The master saith, My time is at hand. I will keep the Passover at thy house with my disciples. And the disciples did as Jesus had appointed them, and they made ready the Passover. Now when the evening was come, he sat down with the 12. And as they did eat, he said, Verily I say unto you, that one of you shall betray me. And they were exceedingly sorrowful, and began every one of them to say unto them, Lord, is it I? And he answered and said, He that dippeth his hand with me. Anyway, you know the rest of this. And then verse 26. And as they were eating, Jesus took the bread and blessed it and broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, Take, eat. This is my body. Take, eat. Don't try not to see the ritual of it. Try not to hear the explanation from these scriptures of the ritual. Try to allow the Holy Spirit to reach into the heart of Jesus and explain his heart. That's what we need. That's what I need. That's what I want. That's what we want. And as they were eating, Jesus took bread and blessed it and broke it and gave it to his... I mean, Jesus is taking bread and blessing it. Come on. You know, is that a Jewish tradition that he's doing? Well, you know, I was taught that we pray over our meals. And I'm fine. I'll tell you what. I was raised in a poor home where we, and in an orphanage, and several orphanages, a bunch of orphanages, and where we didn't get much food. And food was scarce, and good food was even more scarce, and dessert was almost, you know, non-existent. And so I want to pray over my food and say thank you for it, Lord. I've had, you know, people say to me, you know, brother, we don't need to do that ritual over the food. And I said to them, as long as it's a ritual, I agree with you. But I said, I just want to tell my Father thank you for this food because I am genuinely thankful for it. And I meant it, and I do mean it to this day. But picture Jesus. Come on. Is Jesus caught up in a ritual? Is Jesus just going, Father, thank you for this bread. I mean, really, consider the heart of God who created bread. And is he going, wow, I'm really glad we got bread. You know what I mean? I mean, you know, he's the same guy that turned, you know, a little bit of bread into a bunch of bread, you know. It's not like he's going, ooh, I'm really, you know, it's not like a Jesus is a little orphan that hadn't had enough to eat. He can just, you know. His motive is not coming from the earth. His motive, he's looking at that bread and he's going, this is my body. Take this. Eat it. Take it. And then eat it. Take it. Come on. Quit being Christian. Quit being you. And take this and eat it. I just bless this, Father. I bless the reality of it. I bless the fact that there are those who will see beyond the ritual and the ritual elements and enter into it. And he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, Drink ye all of it. For this is my blood of the New Testament. Wait a minute. I thought the blood was just shed there at the doorpost to get us out of the old and into the new. It was in a certain sense. But my point, where I'm trying to go with this is, he didn't say put this on your doorpost. He said drink it. He wants New Testament life. And New Testament life is his blood shed for you. Okay, well, here's all we ever get out of shed blood. Shed for my sins. I probably won't get an opportunity, even though we're in this incredible area of offerings, to really get into the fullness of what the blood is. Just like I just barely touched on Melchizedek and the priesthood thing. I mean, barely, But it's not my job to share everything I know. It's my job to share with you what the Lord gives me, with the hope that that does something in you and spurs your search on. You know, the school isn't like some sort of a platform for me to display all my knowledge or whatever. It's not about that. I hold back sometimes. I hold back a lot of times. I do. But I do that because the Lord says, either, don't go there. I need to teach them that. If you tell them that, they'll think they'll know that, and they won't keep searching and go after me. He cuts me off for your sake because he doesn't want you looking at me as the guru, the you know what I mean? I mean, the big teacher that you come to, I went to Nepal and found this, guy that's going to teach me the mysteries of, crap or whatever, sorry, but I mean, that's what it is. It's just ridiculous. I'm not that, but I can tell you who is. The Holy Spirit. The precious Holy Spirit. And we all have him. Isn't that cool? And he can show you stuff that I don't know, and it probably already is. And that's great. So I just, want to make that absolutely clear. This whole thing of partaking of Jesus is not a feast for sinners. It's a feast for those who have walked and failed. Did I just describe Peter? It's for disciples. It's for those who are committed but not won. No, I know one spiritually, but to the Lord, I want you to know something. To the Lord, they were not won yet, and they weren't. You're not won until the cross and the resurrection. So he's saying to followers, he's saying to committed believers, that's good. Well, how about, John chapter 8 and verse 31. Let me just read it. It's been a while since I've thought of it. John 8 and verse 31, then said Jesus to those Jews who believed on him. Jesus is talking to believers. If you continue in my word, then are you my disciples indeed, and you shall know the truth, and the truth will make you free. Did you hear what that scripture said? Jesus turned to believers. He didn't turn to sinners and say, I tell you what, if you continue, and you come after me, you're going to know the truth. He's saying to people who believe that they don't know the truth. They believe things about him. They don't know the truth himself. So Jesus stopped because a big multitude's coming there in John 8. They're pressing and they're really getting excited. And Jesus stops them in their tracks and says, let's cut the excitement and cut all this. If you'll continue in my word, you're going to know the truth, and then you'll be finally made free. Jesus here is speaking to disciples in Matthew also, when he's sitting down, he's speaking to believing disciples. And he's saying, take, eat of my body. I mentioned this a second ago. Blood Shed blood means more than forgiveness of sins. A lot more. The life blood of Jesus was poured out so that we could pour it in us. It couldn't happen any other way. It was poured out so that we could pour it in us. There is more to this than just forgiving us of our sins. And the Passover, the Lord's Supper, is the proof. In one sense, you could say God already forgave Israel. He was bringing them out. But in another sense, you can say the Passover was God's first step in bringing them in. Now, the reality of them, of their oneness, didn't hit them until the Jordan River. But God instituted it, and it was a reality to him at Passover, at the Lord's Supper. When Jesus did this right here, it settled in his heart. I'm fixing to die. I'm going to shed my blood. You're going to become one with me. You're going to be my branches. I'm going to be your vine. And if you check that out in John, it was right after this that he said all that. You know, they leave the feast. He goes down in the dark, heads for the Garden of Gethsemane, and before he gets there in John, he says, I am the vine, you are the branches. And they're going, what? And he's about to die. They're going, why is he doing all this heavy teaching just before he dies? Because I'd like for you to remember the truth so that when I am risen, you will be one with me in it. All right, so let's hear Jesus' words in John 6. John chapter 6. And verse let's start at verse 1. After these things, Jesus went over the Sea of Galilee, which is the Sea of Tiberias, and a great multitude followed him because they saw his miracles, which he did on those who were diseased. And Jesus went up into a mountain, and there he sat with his disciples. Now, you know, what does the word disciple mean actually in the Greek? Learners. All of this great, it didn't say a multitude, it said a great multitude is following after him because they saw his miracles, and Jesus is not excited. Now, how many big churches are you aware of that they're excited because all the people are seeing miracles and coming to that church because of it? Come on, I'm just trying to make you think. It said Jesus sat down with his disciples and wanted to talk to them about the truth. He didn't want to display more miracles. He didn't go, oh boy, big things are happening. Jesus is doing miracles because he loves people and he blesses them, but he knows that's not the answer. And the proof of that is that he went ahead and died to change our life because we can get a miracle and still be selfish. Can you say, oh me? So, here it is. Jesus is teaching his disciples, but look at verse 4. And the Passover, a feast of the Jews, was near. All right, so all the way through John 6, you read some really, really interesting things here. But let's look in verse 51. There's so much here, but I'm going to just have to skim it. Verse 51, Jesus said, I am the living bread that came down from heaven. If any man eat of this bread, he shall live forever. And the bread that I will give him is my flesh, which I give for the life of the world. Do you hear what he's saying there? I mean, it's not really hidden there. He said, I'm the living bread. You could almost do it like this. Okay. The feast of Passover is near. The feast of unleavened bread is about to start, where all you're going to eat for 7 days is going to be unleavened bread. I am the bread of life. See, a Jew would pick that up immediately. We don't. But a Jew would go, it's Passover. He's, you know, did you hear what he said? You know what I mean? I mean, they would get it. We just go, you know, when Jesus says, I'm the bread of life, we don't relate that to the fulfillment of anything. It's just, yeah, you know, he's the thing that sustains me. He's like Wonder Bread. Only better. because he doesn't have a, he's not a heel, you know, or something. You know, I mean, it's about like that. I mean, I'm trying to help you see this. We're floating around giving explanations for stuff that have no fulfillment of the old covenant. They're just things. We just take them out of context and we just say, well, you know, if you're hungry, come to God and he'll be the bread of life. Well, there's truth to that, but he's not just trying to say he'll satisfy you. He's saying it here in verse 15. I am the living bread. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. If any man eat this bread, I mean, can you see him? He's going, he couldn't say it any plainer unless he said, I am the Passover, which Paul said it in 1 Corinthians 5, 7 and 8 when he said, our Christ, our Passover. I am the Passover. And how did he say? I am the Passover. And if any man eat this bread, you know, he shall live forever. That's because Jesus lives forever. And the bread that I will give is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world. You will take that bread, like Jesus said, and you, but it's not the bread. It's not like a Catholic thing where as soon as you eat it, it turns to Jesus' flesh. That's what they believe. It's sublimation. They believe that once you take that little wafer, it's just a wafer until you put it in your mouth. And then magically it turns into the body of Christ. And you actually literally ate the body of Christ. You can take that and you can put it under a microscope before you eat it, and it's just cheese and crackers or whatever, you know. It's not, it's just that. The DNA will not prove it to be. But somehow, once it's in your mouth, once you swallow it where you can't get a microscope on it, it just magically turned into literally the body of Christ. Well, you know what? I don't even have a problem with that. I mean, I know that's not the truth. I don't have a problem with that because I understand somebody listening to Jesus and going, okay, now, how's that go? And Jesus is talking about this continually. In fact, John 6:66, John 6:66, says, from that time many of his disciples went back and walked no more with him. Why? Because he said, you have to eat my flesh and drink my blood, and they didn't get it. What are we, cannibals? Is that, we ain't following you, Jesus. You're talking about cannibalism or something. No, he's not. He's talking about you becoming his body, you eating of him and his life filling you, and you being the body of Christ. But what's required is not eating a wafer or bread and drinking out of a little cup and saying, because I do this and I drink this, my sins are forgiven, and I, you know, there's so much to that right there, doing in remembrance, but I won't get into it right now. Well, the scriptures say it best, so why sit there and mess with it? Look in just verse 57 and 58. So here's Jesus speaking. As the living Father hath sent me, and I live by the Father, so he that eateth me, even he shall live by me. This is that bread which came down from heaven, not as your fathers did eat manna and are dead. He that eateth of this bread shall live forever. He just says it right there. He says, the living Father sent me, and I live by the Father. What is his explanation of that? The works that I do are not my own, it's the Father in me. The words I speak are not my own, it's the Father in me. Right? I says, okay. As that is true, so he that eateth me, even he shall live by me in this same manner. I will, So eating, folks, is not cannibalism. It's not sublimation. It is our understanding of communion. You know what? You can't commune unless you understand what it is that he's wanting to commune with you, why he desired to eat this Passover so much with his disciples, why it was such a big deal. You've been followers. We're about to change the nature of the whole game. You're not going to be followers outside of me following my teachings anymore. You're going to be one with me. I mean, is that wonderful or what? Jesus is going, man, I desire to eat this Passover with you. You know, and they're probably going, yeah, it's pretty cool. This will be a good Passover. Same event, just a different person. You know what I mean? About the way we do communion. You know, we get all in the ritual. You know, and we get, you know, it's like we hold our little piece and our, oh, it's a holy moment. You know, I get in trouble all the time for cutting up during communion. You know why I do it? Most of the time because I sense a religious spirit of people just going, oh, you shouldn't. Oh, my God, not only you, but the pastor, you shouldn't be sacrilegious during the munching time. Folks, I don't know that you can get any more sacrilegious than eating that and drinking that and having no clue what it is that he desired in his heart when you did it. You know, I think that breaks his heart. I'm not encouraging, you know, from now on, mad chicanery during communion. That's not what I'm talking about. But I'd like for us to really understand these things. No, that's not really true. I feel the heart of the Lord for us to understand these things. That's more the truth than I'd like for, you know, it really is not about me liking, you know. I really so much sense the Lord wanting to communion. Because that's what it is to him. We're coming into union by partaking, not just believing things in our head. What? You know, if y'all really understood what I was saying, you'd be jumping up and running around screaming. That's why somebody says, well, I'm sorry I slept during your class. You know, at least get something out of it. Even if it's a nap. You know, I mean, I don't feel bad. If you're not going to get what I'm saying, get a nap. Man, I'm serious, you know. I mean, I have taught classes where I've had over half the class asleep. No, I have. Not recently, no. But I don't get offended. The only one I get offended with is Ben. Because he's so consistent. I'm kidding. I don't get it. Passover in the truth, in the heart of the Lord, does not represent the beginning of salvation. It represents the beginning of oneness. It is his recognition of what it's all about. And look at the disciples. Clearly they didn't. And I guess he probably knew they wouldn't. I mean, they're kind of going, you know, and Jesus says, you know, now, you know, one of you is going to betray me. And, you know, and they're all going, is it me? You know, it sounds like us. You know, well, am I the one? You know, am I? Because we're not really sure what's going on. You know, so Judas gets up, leaves the room to go turn Jesus in. And the disciples see him get up and think that he got up to go give money to the poor. That's what it says. Are they really in tune here? Are you sensing that they're really going with oneness here? Yeah, devil man here is one with us too. In fact, he's better than all of us. He's going to give money to the poor. You know? So there's no communion yet on their side, but Jesus knows what it means. And Jesus knows this is the beginning of the beginning. You know what I mean? This is the beginning of months right now. We're at it right here. Though you don't get it right now, you are going to get it. And you're going to grow in it. And not only that, I don't have to be here physically. I will be there in you, and this thing will spread and spread and spread and spread and spread, because I'll just keep being the original seed filling every one of them. Everybody. Praise God. Communion. Coming in union with Him. Coming in union. Like Jesus said, it's where what He is. See, sometimes we talk about eating, but we're really still talking about knowing something in our heads. Where what He is comes on the inside of us. We eat His flesh and drink His blood. We are now subsisting by His life. We become His body and the vehicle of His expression. In a real way. In an absolute practical way. Not doctrines. Not just believing Christ in us, but us living our own life. But the actual reality of that, and that's taking place at communion in Jesus' heart, and how long, I don't know, the disciples all of a sudden start seeing it. You know, they start remembering that day. You know, can you see them? All of a sudden it dawns on them, you know, weeks, years, who knows? That's what He meant. That's what was in His heart. Can you see some of them? You know, can you see Thaddeus going, man, I didn't have a clue. I mean, it seemed cool that we were going to have Passover, but Jesus seemed a little bummed out at that meal. You know. Or whatever. Well, I have sat in the midst of great reality before and not understood a thing. I've had the Lord speak to me and me write down notes and years later read it and finally come to the understanding of it and go, when I wrote that or when I preached that, I didn't have a clue of what I thought I was talking about, but I thought I did. That's going to happen to you. You'll look back on some of the stuff you said and whatever, and you'll listen to a tape or you'll read something you wrote, some of your notes, and you'll go, man, that's good. I didn't know that back then. You know what I'm saying? The Holy Spirit will give you stuff, and you'll go, man, that's really good. And you'll see it in your handwriting, and you go, did I write that? Because that's good. But I don't remember writing that, and I really don't remember knowing that. You know? Well, it happens. That's the way it is. This communion is the beginning of months. It's why we have to be brought into remembrance over and over until we get it. What are we going to get? Some sort of a ritual that we do at the Lord's Supper? No. One day, we're going to understand what He meant when He instituted this, and it wasn't about establishing a ritual for the Christian faith. We're going to see what communion is, and we're going to see Passover as not the beginning of the Jews, because it wasn't. Abraham was the beginning of the Jews, not the beginning of God's people. We're going to see it as the beginning when in God's heart, this is it. This is settled in my heart. I died. The Red Sea represents death, just like Jordan represents death. It's just the Red Sea is our recognition of the depth of it, but the Lamb is his recognition of the depth of it. And it is his beginning to look at us and to say, you are one. You are mine. You are not separate. Even if you mess up, even if you do this, even if this and that, this is the Lord speaking, I see you as one with me. Would that help anybody if you ever really saw how he felt about you, how he saw you? Would it help you to realize, my God, I worry 100 times more than I need to. I worry over stuff that he doesn't worry over. Have you ever been all freaked out and gone to the Lord and he didn't seem to even care or be upset? I mean, and you're kind of going, yeah, you should be freaked out. I mean, I'm hanging on the edge here. And he's going, you're fine. You go, I'm not fine. Look at me. I am teetering on blaspheming the Holy Spirit. I'm that far from the unpardonable sin. And you've heard my explanation, some of you have. One time somebody came into my office and they said, oh, Brother Randy, I'm so freaked out. I'm so sorry. I've committed the unpardonable sin. And they're just, I've offended God to the max. I've committed the unpardonable sin, and I can't ever be forgiven. I said, you haven't committed the unpardonable sin. They said, what? How do you know? And I said, if you were, you'd be so dead and so numb and separated from God, you wouldn't be crying or you wouldn't care one iota. The fact that you care, that you want God, tells me the break hasn't happened. And they went, oh. But I mean, that's what we do. We think we're just so, we're dangling our feet at the mouth of hell. And, Jesus walks by and he goes, Jesus, and he goes, hey, how you doing? And keeps going, what? And our response is, carest thou not that we perish? Like the disciples in the boat. And he's going, you ain't going to perish. You are not, first of all, I don't know what you're seeing, but you are not dangling your feet at the mouth of hell. But I see. There is no problem except your mind. Your mind has, was anybody ever into Star Trek when they were all the TV, different Star Trek? And they had this thing called the holodeck. You know what the holodeck was? It was this room that was made of a hologram, and you programmed in what you wanted it to look like, and it could look like a village in Europe, or it could look like a river or a lake or all this, and you could relax and run, and I mean, there's trees, you could climb, you do all this stuff, you could be snow skiing or whatever, and your mind is like a holodeck with a house of horrors programmed into it. And every bad scenario has been put into the holodeck, and you check in your free time into the holodeck and put in these horrible things and go through it, and the Lord's out on the bridge, and he's just taking us to our destination, and we're in the holodeck going, Captain, he goes, yeah, what is it? There's horrible things going on. There's an intruder alert and everything. There ain't no intruder. No, they're all over me, man. And we're all and he's going, look, I'm telling you, we're on course. No, we're not, man, we're not. This is horrible. You got to do something. And he's going, look, I'm going to stay the course here. Do me a favor. Go and turn off the horror holodeck mind. Just turn it off. Click. You know what it looks like. Some of you have seen it. It's just a box with stripes on the wall. Well, this ain't so bad. You know? And so, you know, you start feeling, oh, praise God, you know, and then you lean against it, and it comes back, ah! You know? And you're up and down and back and forth, and, you know, just get the heck out of the holodeck of your mind and come to reality with Jesus. Go up and sit beside the captain chair and watch him in control. You know? He's like Captain Kirk. He's not freaking out. You know? Any of them. Any of the captains. Forget it. Your favorite captain. The captain of your salvation. But, I mean, that is just a real good description of a bunch of you folks, man. You just got just... Your holodeck mind is in pitiful shape, and you need to reprogram it or get out of the holodeck. Either get his thoughts and start programming them into the holodeck or leave the holodeck and just stay with Jesus. Renew your mind, renew your holodeck program. Or get out of your holodeck mind. Quit trying to find reality in what's not real. To do that, you're going to have to come to the beginning of months. And that starts with communing with him where he's at. Communion isn't you bringing a ham sandwich there and asking him to have half of it. You know, I mean, I'm sharing. We're communing. Communion is not you giving him your stuff and him getting with you over it. Communion is him giving you his stuff and you getting with him over it. Amen. You know, we keep trying to offer him our stuff, and then you know, I know this sandwich don't taste real good. Can you heal it? You know, and he's going, look, this is not communion. This is not the bread of life. This is month old bread. It's got penicillin, but not life. We're in John 6. Go to John 1:1, and I'll try to wrap it up with this. You want to start? You want a beginning? Do you want the beginning, the beginning of months? Do you want to reset your clock? Huh? Reset your clock. Get off of your time and start living on his time. Get off of your calendar and start living on his calendar. Well, that's what you're going to have to do. But it starts with oneness, and here it is, John 1:1. In the beginning was the Word. Now, what's it going to say? You know, why didn't this start once upon a time in a galaxy far, far away? Or once upon a time there was a fairy king or something, you know. No, in the beginning there was a God who... you know, wanted to have sweet people or something stupid. No, this is about oneness. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. The Word was God. I'm with, I am. I'm with, and I am. The Word was with, the Word was. Do you see? This is the beginning of days, if you will. It starts with oneness. It starts right there. You say, but I've been a Christian a long time and I haven't got this down. You hadn't started yet. You say, I don't want to hear that. You know, I mean, I've had people say that. I have heard that at least once in my life. I don't want to hear that. It came out of my mouth when the Lord said it to me. I don't want to hear that. I've been, This was where I was at the time. I have prayed for my own mom, and she got healed from cancer. I prayed for a blind man, and he saw. I've been in the Word for a long time. I know a lot of scriptures. I know a lot of stuff. What do you mean I'm just I haven't begun yet? That offended me. What do you mean I haven't begun yet? He said, well, not on my calendar you haven't. Oh, you begun on your calendar, sure. You're years into this thing. Mine, you hadn't even begun yet. And he says, this is the beginning of months right here. This is where it all begins. Oneness with me. Not following me as a disciple, but being one with me as a bride, as a body, as a branch, as a, like a treasure in a vessel. That's my, and see, that's his beginning. Which ought to show you something about his precious heart toward us. That's his beginning. He is not getting off on miracles or multitudes or all the things that make a big evangelist tick. He is not moved, excited, or feels that anything has even happened yet. Why? Because his heart is set on something different than most religionists. His heart is set on us being one with him. And until that starts, he doesn't even feel like we've begun. I don't care how far you got. I don't care what you've done. I don't care who your mama is. You know, it doesn't matter to him. Because it has no semblance of what it is that he's after. It has no semblance. It is off flailing and working wildly for him, but it has missed the mark of his heart. It has not begun yet. Only until they sit down with him. They, his. Only when his own sit down with him. And he says, this is my body. This is my flesh. I want this to be life in you. Just like the Father is in me as my motivation and my life, I want to be in you as your motivation in life. Eat this. Claim it. Partake of it as real. And then when we start doing that, and in reality, it's not even, and I'm going to try to end with this, in reality, it's not even when we start doing it. In reality, it's when he finally feels that he has gotten you to the place where he can even talk to you about this. Where you quit running around trying to be the greatest person of God around and start trying to be his bride, his body, his own. Just be happy to be one with him. Just be content with Jesus and allow him to use you how he will, whether great or small, or not to impress anybody except not to impress him, but to satisfy him. That has to become the theme of your heart, the theme. And when I say that, I don't mean a chosen theme. I mean a branded theme. There's a difference. A chosen theme is when you say, okay, I'm going to do that. You'll stray from it as long as you're choosing it and trying to be something that you're not. You'll mess up. When it becomes branded in your heart, being with him, loving him, satisfying him, knowing him, growing by partaking. Growing by partaking, no more growing in head knowledge, no more growing in ministry. All of that will, you know, stuff happen. You'll know more stuff, surely. You'll have access to all things because you'll have the mind of Christ. Not your own mind, not your own holodeck mind. And you will have resources of character beyond you, beyond your failures, beyond your weaknesses. You will have resources. You will have hope, but the hope won't be something that you hope to get. It will be an expectation. It will be, I expect Christ in me. He is my life. I expect him to show up. Christ in you, the expectation of glory, the hope of glory. Your hope will not rest in yourself anymore or anything within you. That's because communion, the Lord's Supper, Passover. Now, how much time we got? Zero. Oh, we already ran out? Bye, people there. As we continue here just for a moment. That's because communion, the Passover, or let's say this, Passover, in all of its story and all of its reality and all of its Jewish history, comes down to one thing. Jesus sitting down with his disciples, not teaching them. He did that many times. Sitting down with them and saying, I'm about to die to make us one. Here's what I want you to do. Eat. Not truth. But eat, live off of. You understand? I know they're stubborn with that word. Live off of. You're my body. And my life is in you to be the expression through you. That's the explanation in Passover. Jesus summed it all up with communion. Isn't that cool? And then the shadow just went, and all that you want to tack onto it has no more meaning anymore. There's the meaning. There's the guy. There's his heart. And there's his request. What do? We just look at him. We look into his face. We look into his eyes. We look into his heart. And we say, yes, Jesus. We say, yes, Jesus. Yes. Father, we just thank you for your son and his way, his preciousness. I see his preciousness there at that table with the 12 who are very confused, who don't know who's the enemy and who's of God, who don't know their own selves and are asking him, are they going to be the one? Father, they don't. But Jesus, I see you and I see your preciousness. As far as you're concerned, it's about to happen. And their confusion doesn't change your commitment to have them as one. I just love you so much, Jesus. Just want to separate from all the, not the world, not just the world, Lord, separate from all of the busy religious things that we think are so important. And to really, really, really know you, to really, really, really function as extensions of your life, to really, really bring you that satisfaction that all has been forsaken and counted dung to be one with you for the prize of the high calling of being in union with Christ. Father, stir your people, stir their motivation, because Father, you do have to stir our motivation. Until you become our motivation, Jesus, then Holy Spirit, then Father, you have to stir our motivation. Stir it. To get after the Lord, to commit. Father, not to commit to Acts Bible School or New Creation or Randy Nussbaum. For God's sake, Father, no. But that in the hearts of your people here, they would go after you with all their heart, soul, and mind. so that their time here would not be wasted.